Morning. How is everybody after a rough couple of days? We've had some really bad weather. A lot of people were hit. But you know what? We're blessed. We're truly blessed. We're here this morning. And for those who couldn't be here, we just pray for them. And we pray that we get cleaned up and our faith will grow stronger in the Lord, right? Let's stand as we start our worship with Worthy of Worship.
Good morning. We want to welcome you here to First Baptist Church of Lloyd, especially this Mother's Day Sunday. And we know some of that has gotten pushed out because of the events of Friday especially. And so we just are glad you're here, and we're glad, and hopefully you'll be able to honor now and remember and even get a hold of your mother today. And we wish everybody here that's a mother a happy Mother's Day. Again, with the storm coming through, again, we're the body of Christ, and it's time to reach out. And so first of all, we're available. People are available. There are chainsaws that have not been used yet. There are people ready to go. And so one of the things is we have to know the needs. And so again, I know sometimes our culture, no, I've got insurance, I'm just going to call, take care of myself and deal with it, or just leave the tree laying there for who knows how many months and stuff. But again, reach out. Show that little bit of humility and go ahead and reach out and say, I do have a need, or my neighbor has a need. What a great time, again, to reach out as the church and say, in the name of Christ, I cut up this tree and drag it to the road for you. And again, a testimony that that can be. And again, this is a storm. This is a weird storm because, again, I drove from my house to my parents' house, and I saw two trees down. And I was like, What's the big deal? I don't understand. And then I tried to go into Tallahassee. And I got down on the parkway, and I'm like, oh, my goodness. I'm turning around. I'm getting off the roads. They don't need me out here doing this type of work because, again, people now have no power, no power lines, and roads closed and stuff. So, again, you know some of the needs. Facebook, I've seen some of the posts going around and that type of thing. But, again, reach out to people. Reach out to people and be aware of people and be ready to help as we go through this week to recover from this. So, looking at a few announcements coming up. We have a lift tomorrow evening here in the Fellowship Hall, so that'll be as normal. Then on Thursday night, WW Diners. We had a Tallahassee restaurant picked out. We're going to change that because of the chaos there. Let's go ahead and we're going to meet at the Rev Cafe right there downtown Monticello. So that's WW Diners for Thursday night. Do sign up if you're planning on being there so she can let the restaurant know an idea of numbers showing up. Next Sunday, VBS workers meeting. Now, even yesterday, I was trying to make some phone calls, and then I remembered cell signals are even messed up and stuff. People say they got my message, but not until midnight, you know, and that type of thing. So I may not have been able to reach everybody that I'm asking to work for VBS. So if you have any idea or interest that you would be ready to go with VBS this year, I encourage you to come next week. We're going to feed you. We're going to get you all caught up on the theme of this year's thing. You'll start to get the idea that even the lobby is going to change this week a little bit. To get ready for VBS, and you'll see what that theme is and stuff. But if you're at all interested in working, and listen, we are planning for our normal 30, but we are doing some outreach in some creative ways this year, so we also have to plan for 60. So I need about 20 people who are just on standby, and they're Monday, and if we have the 60, then you'll be put to work. And then if not, we'll have other arrangements for you to go for the week and stuff. So come and get all the details next week after church for the VBS workers meeting, and we will be greatly appreciative of that. As we go forward this week, again, a strange week with some people have power, some people don't. Do I go to work? Do I not? That type of thing. Again, find places where you can help out. Again, the body of Christ first, and then reaching out to our neighborhoods and stuff and helping out there. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, again, you are sovereign Father, Lord God Almighty. And these tornadoes did not surprise you in the least. So, Father, we know that there's a reason for everything, and right now is not the time to try to figure it out. But, Father, we know down the road we'll see some of the dots connect, and we know in glory, Lord, that ultimately we'll see all revealed. All is for your glory. And so right now, let us use this time to reach out to people around us in need, to reach out and offer what we can offer in the name of Christ and to the glory of God. We offer you now songs and scripture and prayer, and we ask that you glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen. And here's the scripture for this morning, and it's the one that I finished Sunday school with this morning, Philippians 2:10, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And I went on and talked about the next few verses because, again, we throw all of our rewards and crowns that we get in heaven at Jesus' feet. He turns and he gives it all back to Father Almighty God. All glory to God this morning in Jesus' name.
I live because he is risen. I live.
Good morning, everybody. If it seems a little redundant, they'll probably bring me a battery soon. It'll be all right. So let's try this again. You ready? Good morning, everybody. I'll take it. Listen, I know that the weather's been rough. I know that some of you have had some rough days in the past, but I'd like you to do me a personal favor just for a moment. Could everybody just take a deep breath and then let it out whenever you feel like it? And if you hold your breath too long and pass out, you just go ahead and take a nap. It'll be just fine. Listen, God really protected us this last week, especially in our area. Now, I know that some of you have had your own homes, your family, your friends, and the like. One of the interesting things that happens is that when a storm comes, it tends to catch us by surprise. Let's see if this thing works. How about now? Sue? Otherwise, they're going to get the shortened version. How about now? Can y'all hear me okay? I feel like a Verizon commercial already. Some of y'all are so young, you don't know what that means. Here it is. Last week, Chris did a magnificent job, didn't he? He did great. I was so proud of him. He talked about Galatians 6 and taking our burdens to the Lord last week. I hope you did. I hope you gave it to the Lord and didn't take it home with you. I'm so thankful that we were actually spared from the worst of the things that have happened. But to all those who went around cleaning up tree limbs, taking meals and stuff, thank y'all, as John says, for being the church. Now, there's a couple of things that happened to us last week. We were challenged to give our burdens to the Lord, and then right around the corner was a storm. Here's what's interesting. Even in the storm, you can see the hand of God working. Now, if that doesn't show a picture of our Christian life, I'm not sure what does. So talking about a Christian life, just for a minute, there's a couple announcements we need to make. Next week, Larry, if you would, raise your hand. That's Larry, everybody. Larry and I are going to be teaching a Sunday school class in the education area, room 7, on the book of Job. Now, I know that many of you have gone through the book of Job. That might not be new, and that's okay. We have other classes for you. But for those of you who haven't studied in a while, for those of you who aren't attending a Sunday school class, we hope that you'll join us, because we're going to talk about the trials, the tribulations, not just of Job, but what we experience. We're going to have a good time doing it. Before I forget, Happy Mama's Day! For all our mamas, for all the ladies who have raised somebody else's child, I'm talking teachers, coaches, volunteers, Sunday school, all the in-betweens, for all those mother figures who have taken care of all the different people in life, may God bless you this day. I hope you get a nap. Now, I don't mean the kind of nap where you lay down and then every 5 minutes somebody asks you a question in order for you to rest. Like, how do I do this for you, Mom, now that you're sleeping? I mean that you actually get a nap. Now, that's my gift to you, husbands, boyfriends, children's. Did I forget anybody? Pets. There it is. All right, we covered everything. Here's the deal. Last couple weeks, I got to spend some time with my own mom. And I got to hear some stories that I love the phrase. I've started using it. Shaquille O'Neal said that every story he shares is true, it just might have some barbecue sauce on it. What that means is everything that my mother told me, I asked her specifically, is this actually true? And she would have this little twinkle in her eye, which tells me that this may or may not be embellished for these likes. And all these things that she shared, I said, I got to have your permission to share all these, and I will. But one of the things we got to talking about is things that moms don't say, things that she never would have said. And so I read this, and I asked her, and I'm asking y'all, if this is things that moms would never say, that perhaps curfew is just a general time that you should shoot for. It's not like I'm running a prison around here. I don't know. Maybe your mom said it. I don't know. Just leave all the lights on. It makes the house look so much more cheery. How about, let me smell that shirt. Yep, it's good for another week. Some of y'all don't have boys. How about,
go ahead and keep the stray dog. I'll be glad to feed and walk him every day for you. If Timmy's mom says it's okay with me. I don't have a napkin, just use your shirt. My personal favorite, because we grew up in North Georgia area at times, don't bother wearing a jacket. I'm sure it's not all that bad out there. You see, there are things that moms say. There are things that moms don't say. There are things as Christians we say. There's things as Christians we don't say. And just because someone has an opinion that they throw out there doesn't actually make something true. And so today we're going to continue the sermon that we started a couple weeks back on Acts 13, building off of even what Chris mentioned last week. So would you bow your heads with me as we go to the Lord in prayer and thank God for protecting us and such. Lord, we love you. We praise you. I'm so thankful for our moms. I'm thankful for the women who have been sacrificial in the way they have helped raise children. Lord, I pray a blessing over them, their families and friends this day. And for those ladies that God, somehow their heart needs to be mended today. Would you help them in a very special way by giving them encouragement and comfort? God, you see them like you did Hannah. You love them completely like you did your own earthly mother. And so today, as we open your word, our prayer is simple, that your will be done. And you'll come and get us real soon. We pray that in the name of Jesus. Amen. So, we've been looking at life after the resurrection. And a couple of weeks ago when I started, you need to know there's new believers in the early church. It makes sense, doesn't it? But that they came by the thousands, not just the one here and there. And they're given a new name. They're called the church. Remember, as John mentioned earlier, we're the church. It's not a building. It's not a campus. It's a group of people. It's a group of believers. And so what occurs is that this church we're going to be talking about is the church at Antioch. Now, this church at Antioch is just one of 40 different cities that was mentioned all through Acts. In Acts 13, Paul, Barnabas, they had departed from Perga, and they came to Antioch in Pisidia. And so what happens, they go to a synagogue on a Sabbath day, because that's the day of worship for the Jewish culture. And so when they go in, they're going to have this time of worship. And so as they are candid to do, they read Scripture. And as they read Scripture in the Old Testament, they would also ask other individuals, if you had anything to say, now's a great time to say it. You could imagine our church service, as I mentioned. What if I just came up here one day, just read a little Scripture and goes, all right, who wants to talk? So they did that to Paul. Paul stands up. Incidentally, extra point, don't need it, but I'm offering it anyways. Happy Mom's Day. It's like this. If you ever ask a preacher to say something about God and Scripture, I don't think they ever miss a point. They'll stand up regardless if they have one or not. And this is where you go, amen. Oh, come on, y'all can do better than that. You ask my opinion, I'll give it. Deal? And so here's what happens. All right, now take it a look. Here's what occurred. He stood up, motions with his hand, and says, almost like gather in, pay attention, all of that. He talks to the men of Israel, the people of Israel, and he says, those who fear God, here's the scenario. What happens is, he started with Christ, but the truth is, he said, we got delivered from Egypt. Then he began to mention a few highlights regarding who God put as judge, who put as leaders, and then he put a king, ending with David, just to explain that through the line of David, Christ came, that God sent a Savior. Now, he mentioned prior to the Messiah that although sacrifice, in other words, the bulls, the doves, all the things in between, was the way to get atonement, meaning forgiveness of sin, that even following the law just pointed out the greater need for ultimate forgiveness. If you don't believe me, just for a moment, think about anything you do wrong, just for a brief moment, and make a decision that no matter what occurs, you will never think about it or do it for the next 40 days. And some of you, as you concentrate on trying not to do wrong, that's all that you'll be thinking about instead of what I need to do right, you'll constantly think, don't do wrong. Don't do wrong. Don't do this. Don't do this. And if you're anything like me, you'll probably end up doing it. And so what happened is, Paul says, the more you concentrate on following the law, the more you realize you break. And so what occurs is, he says, it's time to talk about what Jesus did for us on the cross, the tree. He was buried in the tomb. God raised him from the dead, he said. And then he was seen for many days by many different people from Galilee to Jerusalem. And they were his witnesses. They began telling everybody, you won't believe this, but you know that guy Jesus who was doing all the healing? You know the one that was put on the cross and thrown in the tomb? Y'all remember that guy? Yeah, yeah. We saw him walking around. I'm sorry. What? You won't believe this. It was as if he was moving through the street. And so what they would ask is, what do you mean in bigger conversation? And so Paul says, I came to bring you good news. And in that good news, it's the promise that was made to the fathers from the very beginning, that a Savior is coming. All you got to do is reach out for Him. Believe in Him. God fulfilled all of the promises that He had ever promised when He raised Jesus. Therefore, what He says is, let it be known to everybody. Tell all the people that you know. It's quite simple, don't you see, that through this man is preached to you the forgiveness of sin. But you know what we learned through Acts 13 in just a minute? There's a few that don't want forgiveness. They actually don't care. They're even here today. They're watching online. They're in all kinds of churches throughout the world today that no matter what message gets preached, they don't care. Now, you might find that a little odd, but stay with me because it's part of what happens. And see, as far as we're concerned, this wonderful message that Paul spoke to these early Jews and some of the Gentiles is that not everybody received that talk the same way. And so some are going to be filled with joy. Some are going to be filled with anger, or even worse, a spirit of apathy. The I don't care. And so what I mentioned in verse 42 was when the Jews went out of the synagogue after hearing this sermon. After they heard this, it says that the Gentiles begged that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. Now, folks, what you need to know is that they didn't go out like, hey, you know, Paul, you know, sometimes he hits a home run, sometimes he didn't. It says that they actually went out, closed their ears, closed their minds. They went out stomping, mad, upset, fit to be tied. Which means that the same message can make some mad and others glad. And so in 43 it says, when the congregation had broken up, many of the Jews, the ones that were devout proselytes, followed Paul and Barnabas, who, speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. See, like our message, it ought to influence people to continue in the grace of God. That ought to be one of our driving forces. All of this happened in one weekend. That's a pretty impressive weekend, because here's what happened. The result was the Gentiles especially wanted to learn more. They're super excited. And so Paul and Barnabas spoke to them, told them about the grace of God. Many of the Jews, some of the Gentile converts, they believed in the message that Paul and Barnabas kept speaking, and they spent time with them. They followed them home. They wanted to know. And so now we come to the very next Sabbath. And then this next Sabbath, Paul had promised to preach to them, again, the message of the cross, of Christ and His resurrection. So in verse 44, the people had done a great job spreading the news. On the next Sabbath, almost the whole city came together to hear the Word of God. I think I could camp out on that verse just today. What would it be like if all of Lloyd, the metropolis of Lloyd, all 37 people. Actually, I have no idea if that's true. What if all of Monticello went to church today? What if all of Tallahassee, including those who didn't have power yet, What if they all said, you know what? I can get something warm at church. And I don't mean a building. I'm in with one another. But here's what happened. Almost the whole city came together to hear the word of God. But when the Jews saw the multitudes, they were filled with envy and contradicting and blaspheming. They opposed the things spoken by Paul. Then Paul and Barnabas grew bold and said, "It is necessary that the word of God should be spoken to you first. But since you reject it and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, behold, we turn to the Gentiles. So, for the Lord has commanded us," he said, "I have set you as a light to the Gentiles, that you should be for salvation to the ends of the earth." The third point, it's rather simple, but it was life-altering for us, and it was life-altering for the early church. That's for certain. Easy point. Here it is. The message of Jesus is available to everyone now. The message of Jesus is available. That doesn't mean you'll like it. That's important to understand because not everybody's going to agree. Just get two or more people in a room and ask them, "Where do you want to go to lunch today?" I don't think you'll get that many people to all agree instantaneously. I can't even spell that, but I know what it means, right? And so here's what happens. You may not believe this, but the Bible says that almost the whole city came together to hear the word of God, which means that probably the whole city was invited. That becomes critical because let me stress the importance of this, that many of the Jews, these devout proselytes that the Bible says, they followed Paul and Barnabas home and they were told to continue in the grace of God. And then what that meant for them was to turn around and help almost the whole city hear what Jesus said. If I were to tell you, "I want you to go home and continue in the grace of God," some of you would say, "I just need to continue walking in forgiveness. Or I need to just make sure that I'm trying to do God's will." All that, both of those could fit what the early church took it to be is, if I'm going to continue in the grace of God, then I need to invite everybody I know to hear the word of God. And so here's what becomes so significant is that this is what evangelism actually looks like, both in the early church and in our modern church today. If you want to know about the statistics of inviting people, because I like statistics, are you ready? By the way, I had to practice that word a whole bunch. Do y'all know what I mean? Oh, come on, everybody. Do y'all know what I mean? I need a little bit more energy today because it's Mama's Day, which means that some of y'all got to cook. Amen. All right, here we go. Let's talk about what brought you to church. You ready? 6 to 8% walked in on their own initiative. In other words, they looked it up, they drove by, they wanted to see it, whatever it might be, they wanted to come. 2 to 3% of people liked a program that we offered, a specific thing, and that's why they came. 8 to 10% liked the pastor. Wish we could bump that up here. All right. 3 or 4% had a need met by the church. In other words, they didn't know you at all. They called, we helped them, we did something for them, and that's why they're here. 1 to 2% were evangelized. And you're thinking, oh my gosh, that sounds incredibly low. Please understand what that means. That means that people who had never even heard of Jesus before, and people that had no experience with the church or whatever else, that we met them at a gas station, Walmart, or a courthouse, and we just invited them to church, and they came, okay? Now, 3 or 4% were that came because of Sunday school or Bible study. Now, you ready? Do me a favor, if you would, today. Would you do me a favor? If you're here this morning at our church, First Baptist Church of Lloyd, and a family member invited you, asked you to come, or a friend invited you and asked you to come, would you raise your hand? Oh, come on now. Don't say you were born here because only like 3 of you were. That's it. So here's what's interesting. Statistics actually tell us, and some of y'all got married into church. Some of y'all might have been born here, but here it goes. 70 to 85% were invited by a friend, a relative, or a girl or guy they liked. Let me say that again. 70 to 85% were invited by a relative, a friend, or a guy or girl they liked. That's interesting to know. Average is 83% throughout America. 83% are invited by a friend, a relative, somewhere there. That's the national average. Not just Baptists. I'm talking evangelical church. 83%. In fact, Billy Graham statistics, the association says that an average Christian knows seven people who don't know Jesus and don't go to church. What would happen if you had called all seven last week and invited them? Would you have gotten one? You see, we ought to pray for our family, our friends, and our neighbors. We ought to reach out to them, because here's the interesting statistic that no one seems to really go into detail. You ready? If somebody had a cancer, you would tell them all your favorite doctors, and you would also tell them the ones maybe not to go to. You would do whatever you could to help them through the process in order to have just a decent day. But when it comes to eternity, it finds that most Christians don't talk about where to go and what to avoid, like hell. Where to go, which is heaven. The granted gift of eternity because of what Jesus did and not their good works. Now, here's what's interesting though. Just because you invite your family and friends to worship doesn't mean that everything is going to go perfectly even if they show up. You're not finished just because they show up. I hope you noticed what else was in the Word of God this morning. Jealousy and opposition. You see, not everybody was happy about the message of Jesus being available to everybody now. The Jews, up to a point, felt like they had the monopoly on religion. They felt like they had the monopoly on salvation. By the way, those are two different vantage points. You see, if you enter into a relationship with Jesus, you can be religious. But ladies and gentlemen, just because you're religious doesn't mean you know Jesus. And so what's fascinating behind these things is that the Jews showed us what they chose as what was important for them. They chose religion over salvation. And some people in life, here, watching online, in churches today, they tend to think just by going to church it makes the difference. Or they think just because their family is religious that makes a difference. Folks, you can sleep in a garage, but it ain't gonna make you a car. And so what you need to understand is that jealousy from the Jewish perspective became a choice that they make. They made this because they saw the multitudes. They're not just upset about the message. They're upset all these people came. You could take that however you want to. You ever seen two high school teams show up where one has a whole lot of support and the other doesn't have much? They're not jealous over how talented the team is. A lot of people become jealous over a crowd. It's amazing what a crowd can do. So they started contradicting. You see, instead of putting some men to the test and going, let's find out if what they're sharing is true. Let's find out if they're actually honest people. Instead, they became so jealous that they started contradicting the word that Paul was mentioning. They blasphemed him, accused him of being blasphemous. And so what occurred was they started whatever they could do to stop the word of God from being spread. Now, Paul had a choice. When opposition hits, a lot of people tend to shrink away. Some of you have tried to spread the good news. And when you hit a roadblock or you hit somebody who just put the kibosh, slammed the door, whatever it might have been in the middle of your message, you might have been tempted or maybe you even gave up. You see, remember, the evil one doesn't ever want us to share the message of Jesus, especially with lost people. And the best way to keep all those who are lost to himself is to keep them from you as well. Have you ever noticed that when you accepted Jesus and your life began to change, some of you had to turn your back on the friends that you used to have because they brought you all the way down? Now, some of you didn't. Some of you developed a life with Jesus and you found friends left you. And you wondered, what did I do wrong? The answer to that's pretty simple. Probably not a lot. They saw light in you, and light and darkness don't like each other. They saw new things beginning with you. You started talking all this crazy religious talk like, Jesus loves me and I need Him to forgive me. Y'all didn't know that was crazy religious stuff, did you? But for some, it really is. But what happens is people try to shut you down or shut you out, even when you try to invite them over something as innocent as a meal, and when you begin to offer prayer, help them understand the good news of Jesus. But listen, church, this is when we ought to get bold like Paul and Barnabas did. This is not the point where we shrink away. This is not the part where we reject. Paul said that Scripture was fulfilled and telling the Jews what Jesus did first. He fulfilled Scripture. It all worked out. But since they deemed themselves unworthy of everlasting life, these unbelieving Jews had now rejected it. Let me say that again. You ready? There are some people in life who don't know Jesus. But the reason they don't know Jesus is they feel like they're unworthy of a free gift of love. They feel like they've done so many things wrong that they're unlovable. Or they've deemed themselves, they know they're going to hell because of all the bad things that they've done. Paul said there are people that have that mentality. It comes out of their heart. And they don't realize the grace of Jesus Christ. They don't see it because we have to show it. And so here's what happens. Paul had a decision. With all the people stopping him, with all the people trying to get rid of him, is he just going to stop giving the message just because a few said no? And maybe that's your testimony. I tried to tell my family, but they just don't want to hear it. I tried to tell some people at work. They just don't want to know it. I tried to do this at school. I tried to do this on a team. I tried a few. But understand, people, are we talking the mass group or are we just talking about a few? If we're talking about a few, and we typically are, then the power of a few has more power than the Spirit of God in your life? I hope y'all heard that as a question. So let me say it again. Are you telling me that there are a few people in your life that are so anti-Jesus or anti-God? They're so put off by what you're saying that you feel like the few are more powerful than the God who saved you? Oh, no. You see, it was at that point Paul is going to take the good news to Gentiles. Do you know what that means? If there are a few who won't listen to you, then find the ones who will. Find the ones who will engage with you. Find the ones who will talk with you. Find the ones who will have the things. We're not talking doctrine here, ladies and gentlemen. Don't get tripped up into the nuances of the things in between. Talk about Jesus and keep it there. Then go deeper. You with me? So let's change it up. You ready? I like a good meal. I bet y'all didn't know that. It's been a couple of weeks since I've talked about food. Thought I'd mention this. I like a good appetizer. You know why I like a good appetizer? Gets me ready for my meal. But do you understand something, everybody? Some people, you need to ease them into a conversation. And for Paul and Barnabas, they eased people in because they were already following them home. And the encouragement part. When we leave this church, mamas, instead of going home thinking of all the things you do wrong, can we just offer you a hint of encouragement that God loves you, He has saved you, He'll do anything He can for you, and you are truly never as bad as you think you are. Husbands, well, you are bad. So let's move on. So, just kidding about that. All right, here we go. About this point in our message, many of you are thinking, well, because it's Mother's Day, how come he's not you know, 10 easy things to being a better mom, or how do I have a better Mother's Day, or something like this. Isn't he supposed to give advice and all, or at least tell husbands and children that they need to do a better job, right? All of those I slid under the wire. Don't you like that? That's worked out well. But here's the situation. You ready? Absolutely, I can. In fact, this next section, it speaks to the family. It speaks to women. It speaks to men. Here's what happens in verse 48. When the Gentiles heard this, what did they hear? That the Word of God is now available for them too. This was life-altering. They were glad, and they glorified the Word of the Lord. I think that becomes pretty exciting when you hear good news. I like good news. I don't like hearing bad news. For everybody who wants to hear bad news, they want to hear that first, then give me the good news. But for everybody delivering news, they want to give good news and then the bad news. Do you see how that works? So here it is. Good news, everybody. Jesus is available for you all. But bad news is, if you don't believe it, then you know what comes. It's hell. And so they were glad. They glorified. Now, as many had been appointed to eternal life believed, and the word of the Lord was being spread throughout all the region. They were so excited, they were just telling everybody. But the Jews stirred up devout and prominent women, and the chief men of the city raised up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them from the region. But they shook off the dust from their feet against them, came to Iconium, and the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. My last point, but it's going to take me a minute, so please don't run. Here it goes. Families, no matter what, listen to me. People, those who are breathing today, I think that pretty much encompasses everybody, they shouldn't let the opinions of others cause you to be bitter and stir up trouble. You shouldn't allow the opinions of others to cause you to be bitter and stir up trouble. You see, what we see in the early church in our time together is simple. Joy doesn't remain in your life when you let the opinions of others take you away from the truth. When I was a kid, my parents gave me an incredible little toy. Man, I really liked my little toy. It was pretty neat. It could move. It had all the features. And with my imagination, it would really work. Well, my buddy down the road, his dad worked at a different place, and they had a lot of money. And so when I went and visited him, I showed my little buddy my little toy, right? That's what you do when you're a kid, isn't it? If you don't believe me, any man bought a new car lately and did not show it off? All right, there, I can prove my point, right? So here's what happens. I take my little toy, this is it, and I say, look at my little toy. Isn't my little toy awesome? And then you know what happened, don't you? True story. My friend looks at it and goes, yeah, that's fine, but look at mine. Isn't this better? All of a sudden, I looked at my little toy, and I looked at his, and he began to point out how much better his toy was than mine. He began to point out all the features that his toy had that mine did not. And all of a sudden, I started listening to his opinion about his toy, the one that I didn't even have, and I started to like mine less. Some of you have that in your relationships. You hear about this good guy, this good girl. You hear about it in your jobs. Man, this other guy and girl, he gets paid, she gets paid, she does this, she does that. It always seems like the grass can be greener on somebody else's field just because of the opinion they have. But what you don't know is that grass might be greener because it's over a septic tank. You see, for the Jews, they thought what they had was the monopoly. They thought they had the truth. They thought they had all of these things. And in that process of doing it, they are convinced that they're right and that Paul and Barnabas is wrong. The message is wrong. They never even investigated it. They just knew it wasn't lining up with them. And so their opinions must be heard, they thought. And so after two messages, the Gentiles all responded in faith. It's their time, God said. God had been calling all of these individuals to repentance. But the road to salvation, what we learn is that it's narrow. It's not that everybody gets offered this message and then all of a sudden they go, oh man, I've got my way better. It's that the message is available to all and some don't even want to hear it. Some are just floating through life. And here's what I find fascinating. As the whole town was probably invited and almost everybody came, but only some being glad, it's because they received eternal life. So listen to me. I wonder if you're actually happy you're saved. One of the things I want to encourage all of you, moms, dads, children of all ages, have you allowed the world, have you allowed the darts of the evil one to remove the joy of your salvation just because the circumstances are less than ideal? The situations you find you in are less than ideal? You've been through storms and this one was rough. We had two different tornadoes. But some of you have gone through life and instead of looking at God's hand and the salvation He brings and the promises and the things that He does for you, some of you have focused so intently on everything that is wrong in your marriage and your finances, work, school, things that you own. You focus so much on what is wrong that you couldn't spot joy if it smacked you in the face. And you're making a choice like the Jews did, that I want to be miserable today, and I must ask you why. Because the Gentiles received the joy of the Lord because they remembered they're now saved when they used to be lost. And so just for a brief moment, just for a hint of a moment, do you remember what it was like to be lost? Because this week, looking at this message, I thought about it for just a brief second, and I don't ever want to go back there. For some of you, in reality, it might be like this. You love your spouse so much, you don't even want to think about what it's like not to be married to them. Some of you love your children so much, you don't want to imagine life without them. Your grandchildren so much, you don't even want to imagine that. I'm telling you, if that's how you feel about your family, what do you feel about your Lord? And so this day, as I said earlier, this ought to be each one of us that invites people that we know to experience the Word of the Lord. We ought to be so glad. We ought to glorify the Lord. When we were singing earlier, did you feel like you glorified the Lord or did you feel like you were just kind of going through the motions? I just got to get all these words right. These are strange words. I got to make sure I go up when they go up and go down when they go down. How about just glorifying the Lord and let the Lord just enjoy what comes out? How about when you pray later on and you thank God for the meal, that you actually give Him glory that some of you have power and that you're able to prepare that meal. And you ought to be glad that God didn't ever abandon us. You see the point that I'm trying to make, don't you? Listen to me, people of faith. We should help each and every individual that we know at least have an opportunity to have an encounter with Jesus Christ and receive the salvation that He offers. Anytime the message of Jesus is preached, anytime that it is believed, you're going to have on the opposite side of that people who are going to be used of Satan to try to hinder and ultimately stop what's happening. Your life is a life that's changed, and others just want the life that remains the same. And that might be very hard for you to fathom, but it's true. See, these unbelieving Jews, they're not just going to sit back and let Paul and Barnabas just keep talking about Jesus and then just kind of go. You see, first they're going to argue with them. You ever had that moment? You're telling somebody about Jesus? Let me tell you about Jesus. And they just start arguing. I don't mind people that argue. I think all I see is Jewish people in the Old Testament. Did I say that wrong? Let's say it a different way. You ready? Paul described people that argue as people who don't feel worthy to be saved. And then all of a sudden my heart hurts for them. Do you get that? They're not arguing with you. They're arguing with truth. And maybe it's because they just don't feel worthy. None of us are worthy, ladies and gentlemen. It's not that we're so good that Jesus did us a favor by saving us. He did something none of us could do ourselves. So what they did is they argued with him. Well, then they brought legal action. What do you think happens in our government? You know, our government used to have the freedom to pray wherever we wanted, whenever we wanted. But now that's not necessarily the case, is it, ladies and gentlemen? A couple weeks ago, one of the Gideon speakers that was given a testimony, we loved it, but he talked about how they can't get into the school systems like they used to. They can barely get into some of the hotels. And that's just placing this amazing gift of God's Word in the room. It's as if modern times doesn't ever change, does it, folks? See, the devil's not very creative, but he is awfully effective. And he just has the same playbook all the time. If you want to know about the situations in your life, why they always seem to go through these cycles, it's because the devil doesn't know anything new. He just keeps playing the same tune. What changed for us is that God brought in brand new music, brand new life, brand new everything for us. And so after these Jews argued with them, after they brought legal action, now it's time to get rid of them. Now, how did they do it? They did it by influencing others. You see, everyone here is an example to someone else. You're either a good example or you're a bad example, but you are an example. And so for them, what they did was, I need to reject Jesus, so let's get some prominent women in our camp to stand up against what's happening. Now, here's the part that gets me fired. Ready, everybody? Oh, come on, smile at me, everybody. This may be my last sermon after I say these next phrases. Do you know why the Bible said that they recruited prominent women? It is a statistical fact that women talk more than men. Time of death, let's see. Time of death is, it's a statistical fact that when women become passionate about something, they become immovable. I would like to submit to you, having said this, gentlemen, you can quote me later. This might get you out of hot water. As stubborn as guys are, and we are, when a woman is passionate about something, I dare you to talk her out of it. I dare you. Once they have made their mind up about something, until the Holy Spirit changes their mindset, their heart, and their actual knowledge, they are going to be unmovable. And some of you are literally fighting against something, and you don't need to, but explain it instead this direction. See, Paul told us in Colossians, it's God who makes us worthy, and only He can change us. If your husband, wife, son, daughter, co-worker, schoolmate, whoever it is, if they are a stubborn individual, listen to me. And listen well, because here's what Colossians says. 1:12 says, giving thanks to the Father who qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light, that He's delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of His love, whom we have the redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sin. It's the Father we owe our thanks to for changing us, because otherwise we just play the same game in the same playground and we're lost within it. And so what happened is these Jews stirred up prominent women, chief men in the city, because they couldn't do it themselves. You've heard the expression that misery loves company. Well, people don't care if they're right. They only care if you believe in their opinion. I told somebody that I'm completely biased. Having come from Georgia, Coca-Cola has to be the greatest beverage. Then I moved to Pepsi country. I moved to FSU country. I moved. You see what I mean? Lives change. And just because someone has an opinion, what that means is it doesn't have to be right to them. So what we'll do is we'll grab the power people. We'll grab the prominent people. We'll grab the people who talk. We'll grab the people who have influence. We'll grab all of these individuals and we'll start causing doubt just because of the few. You might ask, why would anybody get mad at the grace of God? And why would anybody stir up people like this? It's because the same message that can make some mad make others glad. And whenever you speak about the grace of God, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 1:18, he said, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to those being saved, it's the power of God. It's foolishness for those who are lost. But for those who are saved, the message of the cross is absolutely pivotal to everything. It's the power of God because it was on the cross that He took all of our sin. Not just the big stuff, but everything. And so let me close. And this is my treat to you. When I say let me close, I don't mean 10 more minutes. Here it is. Here's what applies to our homes. They stirred up problems where there was no problem. Do you get it? There are some people in life that with the absence of drama, they create drama. And they thrive on it. And they want you to live in it. And somehow that drama-filled life, I think, becomes something that when all this drama is there, it takes the focus off of them and how they feel. And so these Jews stirred up drama where there was no drama, created problems where there wasn't a problem. In fact, only solutions were being accepted that day. Salvation was being offered. They're glad about it. But if you think Satan wants to allow you to be glad all the days of your life, that is not right. He wants to make you miserable. He'd love it if you go limping into heaven. Well, what do I care? As long as we go. Amen? I'm sorry, let me say that again. What do we care? As long as we go to heaven. So because of that, here's what happens, ladies. Listen, mamas, people in our church, don't ever let anyone convince you to keep doing what you're doing just because you want to and because you listen to somebody else's opinion. You need to investigate. Find out if what you're doing actually makes sense. I shared a story years ago. It was a simple story. The grandchild asked the mom, how come when she put the turkey and the hams in the oven that she cut off the ends? Well, mom didn't know. So she leaned over and asked Grandma, how come we cut off the ends before we put it in the oven? Grandma didn't know. She goes, my mom always did it. So they go over to great-grandma, who's just sitting there watching all the little kiddies play. Great-grandma, how come we always cut off the ends? And she goes, because the oven's too small. I'll let that sink in. I can feel it coming through. They've been doing something for years just because it was a necessity years back, and now it doesn't make any sense, but they don't know how to get out the rut. So listen to me. Here's how you get out of the rut. You turn your eyes on Jesus and you believe in Him. You turn your eyes on Him. You focus on Him. He's the one who can supply you peace. He's the one who can make you glad. If you could make yourself glad, you'd have done it. It doesn't work. There's nothing you can buy that'll make you glad permanently, I promise you. Why? Because everything I buy breaks. There's nothing I can do long term because when I was 18, I used to could do a lot and now I can't. You see, only Jesus can bring gladness in your heart. Ladies, you need to investigate. Chief men, or men who think they're chiefs, how about that? You need to listen to the word of the Lord and not your own heart. The Word of God is written for your understanding. It's written so that you would listen to the counsel of God. And so Matthew Henry said something really, really prominent. He said, it's good to see prominent women that were devout. They were well affected by religious worship. You know, he's right. It was good that these women, these men, came to hear what Jesus said and what Jesus did. But Matthew Henry said, let those, therefore, that have zeal, let it be and see to it that it courted knowledge. In other words, they let zeal get them in trouble. They let passion get them in trouble when it ought to be knowledge that led them along the journey. Some of you this morning don't know who Jesus is. And we're going to sing a hymn, and I want to invite you to come forward, and I want to tell you about the life-altering God of the Bible called Jesus Christ. Some of you let your passion and your zeal get you in trouble because you don't know any better. And this morning we have a beautiful altar, and maybe you've said some things this week. Maybe you've done some things this week. Maybe you've gone some places you shouldn't have gone. And this is the morning where you come to the Lord and you say, Father, forgive me. I spoke when I didn't know. I did when I shouldn't have done. And I'd like you to take over. Some of you this morning, you came, and for a brief moment, you finally remembered that you're saved. I know that sounds a little foreign because some of you have had so much on your life you might have forgotten. But this morning, it is my belief that we all ought to give thanksgiving for what God does. So don't let this song pass you by before you thank the Lord for saving you, for taking care of you, for providing for you. But especially don't let this morning go by without asking Him for the forgiveness you need. Now as we sing, maybe you need to ask somebody in your group for forgiveness. I imagine in hindsight these prominent women, these chief men in Acts 13, that at some point or another, they had to ask the church for their forgiveness, somebody within the body. So maybe it's you this morning. Maybe you're the one who needs to turn to your husband, your wife, your child, your grandchild, your friend, and go, listen, I said some things I shouldn't have said, and I'm sorry. And I know you'll forgive me, but I really want your forgiveness. Don't let this day move without having an encounter with God and making sure you have brought healing to the church. May God bless each and every one of you. You come as the Lord leads. Let's pray. Father, we love you with all our heart, and we dedicate this moment to you. And our prayer is rather simple, that not only your will be done, but that we have the courage and faith to follow it. May you bless us during this time. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Would you stand? Would you come? Boy, there's a lot of truth in that song, isn't there? So what's your worship going to be like today? How are you going to take care of the individuals in your life? Take care of the mamas. Take care of those people who take care of you, right? That's easy. I'm sorry. That part's easy. How about taking care of somebody who doesn't feel like they're worthy? Show them what Jesus did for you. May God bless each and every one of you. I hope you have a fantastic day. Remember what John said. If there's any of you who need some help, please explain what the need is, and we can certainly try our very best, or at least point you in the direction of somebody who can. And so I hope that your homes who are affected come back together nicely. God made the trees. He'll regrow some, so please don't lose any heart over some pine trees. Okay, ladies and gentlemen? God has all the abilities, and may He bless each and every one of you this day. Let's close in prayer. Father, we love You. We thank You for the trees, the birds that made their nests in it. And I know that even though many of them are laying on the ground, that You have always taken care of Your creation, and You take care of us too. May You bless each and every one this day. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Goodbye, everybody.